喂 ，testing 系。咁我哋咧就够人数咧，我哋可以开会啦。
We have a quorum, so let's get started. The chairman, Mr. Martin Liao, is unable to attend, and so I will preside over the meeting as vice chairman. First item on the agenda, and minutes of the meeting on the 23rd of February has been circulated, and the secretariat did not receive any amendment suggestions from members. So let's confirm the minutes. Item number two, information papers issued since the last meeting. Since the last meeting, a list of information papers circulated to members have been listed on the agenda. I would not read out the names of the papers one by one. If we have no objections, let's move on to agenda item number three. Items for discussion at the next meeting. We have a list of outstanding items and a list of follow-up actions. Let's invite the administration in. The next meeting will be held on the 15th of May, which is a Monday at 2:30 p.m. I'd like to invite the administration to tell us about the discussion items for next time. Chairman, before we move on to that, at the last meeting, I asked the chairman about the progress of including the chief executive in the anti-bribery ordinance or corruption ordinance. I'd like to know the progress since the last meeting. As I remember, last time the chairman asked the administration to follow up on that. And a reply was requested before June this year, and the administration will provide a response before that. Anything to add? That is the ambit of the administration wing. So I'd like to. So we will see. We will check their progress. Yes, we have taken note of your request, and a reply will be provided by June this year. As I remember, I did not request a reply. I wanted to incorporate that on the agenda. And from your communication with the administration wing, do you have any views? We will again relay your views to them. Mr. Lam, we have taken note of your comment or your request to incorporate that onto the agenda, and the government will follow up on that later. And can Ms. Rosanna Law, Deputy Secretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs, walk us through the two items to be discussed next time? Next time, we will discuss two items. First, a review on the number of elected seats in the six district councils. And according to the EAC ordinance, the EAC would review the number of elected seats at district council elections ahead of the elections. In line with the EAC's work, we are already reviewing the number of elected seats for the six DC elections, and hopefully we can take in views from members, and we can discuss that at the next meeting. And second, work progress on eliminating discrimination against sexual orientation and sexual identity. And a discussion has been conducted, and at the next meeting, we hope to report to members the progress of the relevant work. Thank you very much. Any further comments on the items to be discussed next time? If not, let's move on to the next agenda item. Review of penalties and introduction of address proof requirement in relation to voter registration system. I'd like to invite Ms. Law, Deputy Secretary for CMA, to brief us on the information paper before we open the floor for questions. Thank you very much. And we are following up on the public consultation conducted by the government in 2015, and we followed up on the consultation report on enhancement of voter registration system. This time, we want to focus on the elevation of penalties in relation to the voter registration system, as well as the introduction of the address proof requirement. In terms of penalties, for offenses of making false claims, we propose revising the EAC Ordinance CAF 541B on the making of false statements, and the current penalty is level 2 or $5,000 and imprisonment for 6 months, and we suggest elevating or increasing the maximum penalty to $500,000 and 7 years of imprisonment. And according to the consultation, the general view supports this amendment, and the general view is that making false statements in voter registration will affect the fairness and impartiality of the election system. And in terms of introducing the requirement of submitting address proofs during public consultation, most respondents support the introduction of address proofs by electors during voter registration. This would help verify the authenticity of information provided and prevent vote rigging. And this is a significant change to our VR system. So we have considered a number of factors. In the 2015 VR cycle, the Registration and Electoral Office received complaints on electors being impersonated in submitting VR applications. If an elector realizes that his or her address has been changed, then the elector is no longer allowed to vote in his or her constituency, and we should put an end to that. And during public consultation, there were views that the introduction of this requirement would discourage voters from signing up, especially if they fail to submit address proofs within a VR cycle. Under current laws, there is no requirement requiring voters to declare any change of address, and as such, voters would not lose their eligibility to vote, but they can only vote in their original constituency. In order to make sure that the new measure can be implemented effectively, and for the public to understand this requirement, and in order not to discourage voters, we have decided to adopt a gradual approach. We would first require existing voters to submit proof of address, and after the new measure is implemented, we will consider extending this requirement to new registrations. Meanwhile, in line with the new requirement, we have suggested a number of measures.
First of all, if the elector applies for a change of address proofs, is a PRH tenant, or if the EAC, with the assistance of the Immigration Department, the Housing Department, and if in paragraph 17, we've provided for the details regarding this proposal, that for years during which is not a year for the district council election, the statutory deadline for amending the particulars. Now, the arrangement for, we are proposing that the statutory deadline for changing the registering particulars should be advanced by 30 days so that the EAC can make sure that the elector can submit the particulars about the addresses, but the deadline of the 2nd of May will remain to change the same. The EAC will also publish a list of the change in particulars of electors. Finally, I'd like to also mention the view of the EAC. The EAC believe that any application for new registration or change of particulars, we should introduce a requirement of address proof in order to ensure the accuracy of the register of voters. We think that there is an urgent need to first of all implement the requirement for address proof for application for change of particulars in order to prevent third parties for applying for a third party impersonating others to submit via application. And also on the premise that it will not affect the voting right of the electors. The EAC believe that in the long term, the requirement for address proof should be extended to new registrations. So the subsidiary legislation will be drafted by the EAC. The EAC therefore would like to listen to the views of members before proposing this requirement for address proofs. Having heard members' views today, we will discuss with the EAC and work on the details for the legislative proposal before submitting them to Legco. Thank you very much. I'll now read out the names of members who have indicated that they would like to speak. Claudia Mo, Dr. N. Jiang, Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, Mr. Cheng Chung Tai, Mr. Alvin Yang, Shang Kwan Pun Xiaoping, myself, Dr. K.K. Kwok, Dr. Yu Chung Yin. Are there any other members who would like to speak? Mr. Eddie G. as well. Right. So may I propose that each member be given 3 minutes, inclusive of questions and answers. We'll start with Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you. Regarding the details of the 3.8 million registered voters, you are now proposing that there should be a requirement for address proofs. Are you worried that this might actually adversely affect the incentive of people to register as voters? I think Ms. Mo has also pointed out our concern, that is for newly registered voters, we hope that will not adversely affect the incentive to register. for voters who are already registered, but if they subsequently want to amend the details of address, only then we will require them to submit any address proofs. For anyone who is not a voter at the moment, if they apply for a new registration, we will not require them to submit address proofs. I've mentioned twice that both ourselves and EAC believe that in the long term, even for new registration, we should also require the applicant to submit address proofs in order that the information on the registered voters will be accurate. We have the same concern as Ms. Mo, that is, before the voters are accustomed to this requirement, we don't want to, you know, dampen the incentive to register as voters. Aren't we then putting the cart before the horse? We want to verify the addresses of the applicant. If you do not require the new applicants to submit address proofs, this will be self-defeating because subsequently they may have to furnish such details to you. I propose that you should, you know, impose this requirement for address proof, you know, once and for all for both application for new registration and also subsequent amendments of details. Of course, regarding the loss of the voters' information, the police is conducting an investigation, so is the Privacy Commission. I've also heading a working group. I understand that. Do you have a timetable? Let's say, would you be able to identify those stolen computers by July 1st? We hope, I think that would depend on the progress of the police investigation. Well, I hope that you should impose the requirement for address proof for both application for new registration and amendment of details, and the penalty is now raised from 5,000 to 2,000 for subsequent offences. I think it should be raised to 4 years and a fine of $20,000. According to the ordinance, if anyone should make any false statement, it would already be an offence. But still, up to now, I don't understand. In 2011, during the district council election, there were 13 voters registered at the same premises. Eventually, nothing had happened. All 8 persons concerned had been found not guilty. Does it mean the EAC did not play any role in the prosecution of such persons? When there are such cases, either there would have been voters who have complained to us and we will refer the complaints to the law enforcement authorities, or some voters have reported directly to the police. When it comes to the stage of prosecution, it will be for the Attorney General and the court to decide. Eventually, I think the court ruled that there was insufficient evidence. I'm sorry, Ms. Mo, your time is up. Next, Dr. Han Jiang. Thank you. Chairman, I still think that this time we are again discussing the question of the requirement for address proofs. I think the Bureau should really consider this seriously. You're now proposing to increase the penalty. I think that will really kill the incentive of people who would otherwise want to register as voters. Many people do not, stay in the same premises all the time. They may be in and out of town, and it's not like people in other countries where they stay in the same premises for life. And sometimes for young people, they might have registered, they might want to register, but they are not able to provide you with the address proof because all the deposits for, the utilities like water and so on, or electricity tariffs are not registered in the names. So in other words, what you're now proposing may dampen the incentive to register as voters. Furthermore, you're proposing a penalty of 2 years imprisonment. Is it really important that people should give you the genuine address details? If somebody has moved and it's all right, you said if they've forgotten to amend the address details, they can still continue to vote. So it's not important in which constituency they vote. If that's the case, I really like to know whether in other, you look at the practices in other jurisdictions, what is the system in those jurisdictions? Is it that voters must vote in the constituency where they reside in, or have they frequently arrested people for making false registration or furnishing false address details? Has that happened in other jurisdictions, or is this a problem unique for Hong Kong? Dr. Chang, first of all, we agree, as I answer Ms. Mo's question, and also when I made my opening remarks, for newly registered voters, if we impose the requirement for address proofs, some applicants may find it rather cumbersome, and they may decide not to register as voters at all. So we therefore like to adopt a progressive approach. We will impose the requirement for those who want to amend, registration details, because we had indeed encountered, cases where the addresses of voters have been amended, and that's why we conducted the review. We are now proposing that voters who have moved may not have to update their details, although we always appeal to voters to update the details. But if the voters forgotten to do that, we will not deprive him or her of this right to vote. Now that we are imposing the requirement for address proofs, we will step up the publicity to help the public understand this new policy, and to help them understand that amending the address details of the voters is very important. Otherwise, when we send out the notice, the voting card for the registered voters, and if it's returned to us, then we would make inquiries, so we would have ways to find out. So we hope that our new proposal has struck the right balance. As for the practice in other jurisdictions, there are countries which require proof of address. For example, in Canada, when voters want to amend their particulars, they are required to provide address proofs. But in the UK, they do not. Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, I think the question of vote planting during the course of voter registration is a problem. The government proposed since that they want to prevent the problem from deteriorating, and you're now proposing that those who want to amend their address particulars will need to provide details regarding their address details, but not for new registration of voters. It would appear that for new registration, people can continue to plant votes by using fake addresses. So this progressive approach will not work. We've seen many suspected cases of vote planting, which did not really involve people who want to change their address details, but it also involved many new registration of voters. So you say you want to adopt a progressive approach. Does it mean that you're going to have a review in 2047? If some people cannot provide you with the address proof after they have moved, how are you going to deal with that? Let's say if they live in rooftop structures. Thank you. Let me answer your second question first, Mr. Lam, regarding the progressive approach. Several members have commented on that as well. If someone doesn't have a permanent, place of residence. In the voters register, we have also registered people who are homeless as voters. Of course, they will not have details regarding their residence. In this case, we will still allow them to give us a correspondence address. I'll ask Mr. Wong to further elaborate on the details. Thank you. In some circumstances, the voter may not have an effective address, or if by providing us with a correspondent address, we would in some circumstances still accept that. There have been individual street sleepers who may reside or sleep in a park, and the postman will not be able to, you know, deliver the mails to him. However, through NGOs, and if we could verify the status of this person, we will accept the correspondent's address. Understood. Could the government tell us whether or not you are making it easier for people to continue to plant votes in respect of the new registration, people want to vote who are newly applying for new registration? So what is the long term? Do you have a date for the review? We will first have to implement our proposal and see how it works first. As to whether or not we are, creating a loophole, that will not happen. Even for people registering as new voters, and if we send out correspondence to that person, if the mail cannot reach that person, we will also make inquiries. So these are the things that we can do to block such loopholes.
Dr. Chen Chongtai, thank you. First of all, I'd like to talk about change of particulars for existing voters and registration of new voters. Is there any roadmap, and can you tell us about the procedures you will carry out? Thank you. First of all, we already conducted a review based on the public consultation results. And if panel members support our proposal, we will discuss the arrangements in detail with the EAC next month. And this is a piece of subsidiary legislation to be made under the EOC rather than the REO. And after we iron out the details, we will proceed to the drafting with DOJ. And before the LegCo recess or after the summer break, we will table the subsidiary legislation to LegCo by way of negative vetting. If LegCo supports the subsidiary legislation, our goal is to implement it by the end of this year or early next year. And the REO still has some procedures to go through, for example, updating programs, and we will do these simultaneously. On one hand, we will begin the drafting. On the other, we will start the preparation work. And by the end of this year or early next year, the new arrangement can be implemented. Ahead of the next peak period for VR registration, the work would have been completed. So do you mean that you will carry out the change in voter particulars in early or mid next year? And you will deal with the address proof requirement for new voters after the middle of next year, right? Yes, this is the general view. And the new particulars can be updated ahead of the VR cycle. And based on the voters' response, we would consider when to introduce a new requirement for new voters. So in other words, before 2019, the VR system will incorporate the subsidiary legislation on the address proof requirement. Is that correct? For registered voters, if they want to update their address, as I said, the target is for the subsidiary legislation to be passed at LegCo by the end of this year or early next year. Next, Ms. Elvin Young. Thank you. I have a rather technical question. For the random inspections of addresses by the REO. Are you going to inspect a specific percentage of voters every year for both election years and non-election years? We will sample 1% of the total number of registered voters for inspections. Of this 1% of voters, how many voters have had their qualifications cancelled since they do not fulfill the requirements? I have no such figures on hand. But as I remember, we not a lot of registrations were cancelled. It really depends on when the applications were submitted. For those for last-minute applications, if we saw any issues and if the applicant could not provide the information required on time, the statutory deadline might have lapsed. If the statutory deadline passed, if the necessary information is not submitted on time, the registration will be cancelled. This is generally true. And the names of these voters would not show up on the registers since certain particulars have not been provided. If information is provided after the deadline, the voters' names would show up on the next registers. Chairman, of course, we cannot say whether the 1% sampling is enough, but due to the doubts on the authenticity of voters' particular, I suggest the government to increase the sampling percentage from 1%. To a more reasonable level. For the address proof requirement, I understand that a lot of young people might not be able to show proof of address. So if an applicant requires a change in address, can the REO mail a slip to be returned to the REO by the voter? This way, you can allow more young people to sign up as voters who have no address proof. Would you consider this? We will study the feasibility, especially on the sampling percentage. Next, Ms. Starry Lee. All right, Mr. Horace Chang. Thank you. For change of address for registered voters, they have to provide proof. We certainly support this proposal because this would avoid malicious change of voter particulars by third parties. As for newly registered voters, we should not impose too many constraints. As you know, it took us a lot of effort to persuade people to sign up as voters. We had to spend a lot of efforts. Very often, we had to create street booths on voter registration. If you require them to show proof of address, this would impose a new barrier for future voter registration. On the VR system, we discussed this recently with the administration, and we asked some questions about VR. For example, abuse of the VR system. For instance, some third parties might question the validity of registrations And last time, we asked the government whether there's any mechanism to prevent abuse and whether there are penalties. I'd like to know the progress. As for the requirement of proof of address, I'd like to know the details. Do they have to provide utility bills, or would address proofs by telecommunications company or other companies be accepted? And for the election last time, a lot of people said they could not cast a second vote. And we would like to follow up on that. What about the confusion at the ballot stations last time? When will the government give us a response? So on the three questions, any response? In February, we talked about voter registration as well. And if frivolous or ungrounded change of voter particulars are submitted, I think the burden of providing information should be the person making the application himself. As for penalties, we will follow the existing electoral ordinances, and we hope to raise the penalties on the making of false claims. As to what constitutes a valid proof of address, we will discuss the details with the EAC. If currently, if the REO requires proof of address during inspections, apart from utility bills for letters issued by banks, the government, tertiary institutions, etc., they would be accepted as proof of address. As for the third question, I think Mr. Cheng was referring to the DC second constituency, or the super seat. In future voter registration forms, we will clarify the relevant boxes. The existing form is a little ambiguous, and we will clarify the form so that voters would automatically be eligible without ticking any boxes, unless they are not willing to do so. And if members are interested, we are happy to report the information next time. Mr. Hun Xiuheng, thank you. In terms of raising penalties, the existing penalty is $5,000 to $10,000 and imprisonment of 6 months to 2 years. I think you are proposing this change. Some penalties are doubled, some tripled. What is your consideration? In the past, how many people have violated this ordinance? Some members asked about submitting proof of address. In 2016, you started mailing out letters to voters for unclaimed letters or undelivered letters. Well, how many of them were recorded? I will answer the first two questions before I defer to Mr. Wang for the third. We made reference to the penalties of related offenses, and for the criminal offenses ordinance, the making of false statements is subject to a maximum fine of $10,000 and 2 years, and we find these offenses comparable. for the rates ordinance. In the rates ordinance, if anyone knowingly make any false claims in a returns, the maximum penalty is $25,000. But there would not be any imprisonment. So we have taken reference to comparable offenses. As for prosecution figures, and in the 2011 DC elections, for prosecutions on the submission of false claims of false addresses, there were 7 prosecutions, and all of them were convicted, and suspended sentences were given. So we could see that the courts preferred granting imprisonment sentences rather than fines. We can provide some figures for reference. For the 2016 VR cycle, for return notification cards, we sent out 47,000 inquiry letters, and around 10,000 effective voters returned, and so this is the number of returned notification cards or letters.
Now my turn. Regarding the voters who want to change the registration particulars, I agree that we should require them to submit address proofs. This is an effective mechanism. But if you should require all new applicants for new registration and require them to provide address proofs, I would have my reservations, because this would add to the burden. It would also create some complications and dampen the incentive for these people to register as voters. So we need to deal with this carefully. I have another question which other colleagues have already asked already. That is, in the last electoral election, especially the Super DC functional constituency election, in many instances, voters have gone to the polling station and found that they could not cast a second vote for the DC second functional constituency seats, and the staff of the RU were not able to help them at the polling station at the time. I had suggested that in the voter registration form, you should try to, enhance or streamline the mechanism for to make it easier for people to fill up the registration forms. And I wonder whether or not the staff, the RUO staff at the polling station, could provide more assistance to voters. Some voters said that they could not cast a second vote, and the RUO staff at the polling station were not able to help them. So I'd like to ask the administration whether they have a response to that question. Well, we've not provided details on this point in our paper today. At the last time we came to this committee and discussed the report on the 2016 legislative election, we said that we took a lot of importance to this problem. We've checked all the people who've lost the second vote in the electoral election, DC second functional constituency votes. So our staff at the polling station, in verifying the status as voters, have found that these people have in fact given up their second vote. And this is unfortunate. So we immediately look at the form and try to find out why they have given up the right to cast a second vote. If we discover that the people do not read that form carefully, there's a possibility that they might, make a mistake. So that's why we will rewrite that section of the application form. So for people who don't want to give up the second DC vote, they don't need to fill up that section. So for people who are applying to be new, registering as new voters, they should pay particular attention to this part. For people who have inadvertently given up the second vote, we should tell them that they might have to apply again to in order to regain their second vote. Dr. KK Kwok, question on logic. I fully welcome the proposed amendment to the ordinance. I'm sure this will effectively tackle the question of vote planting. But you only propose to impose the sanctions in respect of a change of registration particulars, but not for new registration. It's not logical. If you want to plug the loophole, you shouldn't, you know, try to address a problem which is happening all the time. And another issue is that, let's say, in the, you know, homes for the elderly and homes for the mentally disabled, there have been instances of tree planting already, and some people have registered voters in a dishonest manner. According to what you're now proposing now, the situation will never be rectified, because the you know, the vote has been planted already, and there is no change of address. So somebody has already dishonestly registered the these voters. Thirdly, you say that what you're proposing is logical. That is, other than homes for the elderly, there are people who have planted votes and done something illegal in the past. Of course, you can say you can always enforce the law, but before you do, the government is publicly tolerating these people to use fake addresses. Why is that the case? Why don't you have a timetable saying that you will do this for, you know, in stage one, and then subsequently you would impose this requirement for address proof for all registered voters? Why won't you do that? For new registration, I said at the beginning that we need to be careful here, because we have been encouraging more people to register as voters. So I don't think we have too much time. Why don't you answer my question? That is, for those votes which have already been planted, for people staying in homes for the elderly and homes for the mentally disabled, even if we were to immediately introduce these new measures, if hypothetically the situation Dr. Kwok referred to exists, we still cannot resolve the problem. What about, new registration for people who stay in homes for the elderly? So I think introducing this requirement for address proof is something that we will do. But when are you going to do it? But I think we've also heard people expressing concern. Well, you must have a yardstick. You must tell us when you will be, imposing this new requirement. Well, Chairman, all I can say is that we have to wait until the proposal for address proof when people try to change the registration particulars before we would consider what we should do in respect of new registration. In the long run, we will do it. As to whether or not there is no mechanism to deal with the problem at the moment, the chief electoral officer said, and I've also said, that we would also make inquiries ourselves. And for the voter registration card, if they were rejected and returned to us, we immediately make inquiries. And other than writing to these voters, we would notify these voters by telephone or email. And we're doing a lot of to tackle the problem. So in other words, you have to wait for 2047. Dr. Yeo Chung Yim, thank you. I am against your progressive approach. The purpose of the proposed legislation is to combat certain crimes, including tree planting and providing fake addresses. If you want to tackle criminal act, you shouldn't adopt a progressive approach unless you are condoning such criminal activities. So I think you should immediately impose this requirement for verification of addresses. Like Dr. Kwok said, people who have already furnished fake address details. If you don't impose the same requirement of address proof at the same time, you will not be able to put an end to such illegal behavior, such as tree vote planting. Just imagine that. It will be very difficult for you to enforce the law. If somebody come and apply for changing his registration details and the address he declare you do not approve, the question is, are you going to check his old address? If you do, you may discover that the previous address he submitted is not acceptable either. In that case, you will be caught in a dilemma. You say you're not going to check the old address, but you won't approve his new address. So in this case, can this person continue to vote, you know, based on his old address, but you know that the old address was a fake address? But you still allow? Are you going to still allow him to vote in that constituency where the old address is located? Chairman, what we're now proposing is that for voters who are already registered, if they, you know, volunteer to apply for a change in registration particulars, we would require them to submit address proofs. We would assume that the voter has moved, and requiring him to provide address proof would not be very onerous. Of course, initially the voter may not know what are the address proofs that we require. Could it be, for example, a weekly magazine that is mailed to his address, and then our colleagues will tell him that that's not good enough. So we would advance the statutory line supplying the address proofs, so that our colleagues will have more time to ask him to provide the necessary information. Well, this is hypothetical. If somebody, you know, first, you know, submitted a fake address and he will now want to apply to change that to another fake address, so that is hypothetical. Now, according to your paper, for people living in a public housing estates, 35% of them don't have to provide address proofs. If you include HOS flats as well, more than half of the voters will not need to provide address proofs. So I therefore think that you should, you know, consider imposing this requirement across the board. For PRH tenants, we can certainly check. But for HOS residents, after the owner has bought the unit, his children that may stay in the unit as well. So we're not so stringent in respect of HOS flats. Well, four more members would like to speak for the second round. For the first round, Eddie Chi, Luk Chung Jin, Mr. Paul Chair. Oh, you put up your hand, okay. And Mr. Chen Chi-Chin. So, in that case, I'll have to draw a line here, because we have almost used up the time for the first item. Eddie Chi, several short questions. First of all, for people living in PRH estates, Have you cross-checked the public housing, you know, tenancy register with the voter register to verify that the voter indeed live in that public housing estate? And secondly, it was suggested for people who have moved and have forgotten to change the address details, he can still vote in the old address, in the constituency where his old address is. So if you allow people to do this, is there a deadline, or can this voter, you know, still vote in the previous district where he lived, even 10 years or 20 years after he has moved? So if many voters do that, I would not be able to cater to the needs properly. And to elaborate more on my second question, the situation is very common in some of the villages. As people may have moved out of a village, the second generation might have moved out of the villages. but they have registered themselves as voters using the address of their ancestral home. So for a situation like that, how are you going to deal with the problem? And thirdly, the question is about the correspondence address. And I think the RUO colleague also touched on this earlier. And it's not just about the street sleepers. In many of the villages, when the villages don't have specific addresses, they are still allowed to use a correspondence address, or they may use a store, or even just put on the name of the village, and the store can collect the mails on their behalf. And this is a major loophole. I don't know whether or not you've considered how you can plug that loophole.
Finally, for the elections of village representatives, right now, there are two rounds of registration, unlike the DC and legislative elections. Are you going to consolidate these two registration cycles? Please be brief. I will talk about the fourth question first. For election of the village representative elections, it's under the ambit of the HAD, so I have no information on hand. For PRH tenants, we will cross-check the information against the registers of the housing department. And if the information aligns, that's fine. If not, we would ask for proof of address from the voters. As for correspondence addresses in rural areas, I'd like to invite Mr. Wong to offer an answer. If a voter refuses to change the registered address, then he or she will still be considered a voter in that rural area. If, however, if a voter neglects to update the information, then we might offer a grace period for a year, but come the next election, he will not receive a poll card, so we would not tolerate these scenarios forever. Mr. Wong, as for the issue of correspondence addresses, some voters indeed have difficulties receiving mail with their own addresses, and we would deal with these cases one by one. If they have genuine difficulties, we might allow them to offer a correspondence address, but we are not talking about many voters. For sometimes people live in a particular village, and the address only carries the name of the village and nothing else. Mr. Wong? If their correspondence address is accepted, we will send a mail with the correspondence address. I'm talking about scenarios in which the address only contains the village name. I think that's about time. Next, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. I want to ask about the voters. First of all, are you going to introduce a system which does not require any registration? Are you referring to a automatic registration or default registration system? According to your in your computer systems, you can tell which persons are automatically eligible. So in other words, we no longer require any voter registration system in the future. Then you can tackle this issue. This is beyond the ambit of our proposal. This is a much bigger question. I think you are just wasting time discussing this. Right now, voters some voters might prefer to vote in certain constituencies because there are a lot of uncontested candidates in district councils and the distribution is uneven. If everyone is a voter, for example, if my party wants to set up camp in NT-West, then we might suffer in other constituencies. The geographic distribution is very important. District councils have no power. Well, my voters have left NT-East, but they go back every year to vote for me. Some of them have moved to Kowloon West, but they said they support long hair, so they would come back to NT-East for the voting. So we have no district administration in Hong Kong. We don't have something called the Kowloon West Council. So would you consider such behavior wrong? Well, I talked about the grace period. It's not a permanent exemption. But that's not the focus here. Due to the VR system, some people have lost the right to vote. This is the biggest sin as to where people want to vote or want to choose to vote. This is not a big matter. You have to consider the number of people who lost the chance to vote because of the VR system. This is the real problem. Please be brief. If we are to introduce a default voter registration system instead of a voluntary registration system, this is a big move and or a big change, and we have to be very careful. In other countries, they very often they adopt a a local account system in order to implement this default registration system. Mr. Michael Lok, we should not tolerate any kind of vote rigging in order to safeguard the impartiality and fairness of elections. But I also agree partly with Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. The right to vote is pivotal. Under the proposal, penalties for making false claims would be increased. I think this is irrelevant. Well, I think this is not disputable at all. As for the VR system, I'm rather neutral, but I have my concerns. A lot of young people, especially those who just turned 18, as well as elderly people, they allow their families to deal with everything in life, and they would not see any letters. So in that case, would it be hard to implement a VR system? And has the REO assessed the number of people who failed to sign up as voters due to a lack of address proof? And what will you do on that? I would ask Mr. Wong to speak on that. Our proposal focuses on the submission of proof of address who are already registered. For newly registered voters, we will not ask for address proof. You said proof will be required for change of address, and this is reasonable because one of our party members, Lau Kwai-yong, had his address amended without knowing. On the long run, you said voter registration will be introduced for new voters. I think you have to conduct an accurate assessment, or else you would affect the right to vote for certain voters. Recently, you did a lot of cross-tracking, which is good. but you only resorted to phone calls and letters rather than physical visits, and you are being very lazy. A lot of people, including elderly people, have difficulties reading letters, and as such, they might not be able to reply in time. Because of these stringent measures, some people have lost the right to vote, and you have to deal with this. For vote rigging, of course, there should be zero tolerance. But is it worth adopting or requiring proof of address instead of using confidence? I think you might be a bit too harsh. As we said right from the start, we will require proof of address for all existing and new voters. But since a number of members have reminded us today on concerns for new voters, their right to vote might be jeopardized. So we would certainly consider that. So that's why we propose implementing the arrangement for registered voters first. Next, Mr. Paul Chair. Chairman, in order to save administrative costs and streamline the procedures, I have always requested the adoption of a default registration system for all individuals age 18 and above. I agree that we should deal with existing voters followed by new voters. And from an administrative point of view, this is acceptable. According to your paper, you said there are several types of voters, including those living in HD or HS tenants. They would be exempted. And for other departments, what other departments have such collaboration arrangement in place? For the change of Hong Kong identity card particulars, would there be an option to inform REO? What about other departments? I'd like to know about the details. Mr. Wong. Chairman. The paper talked about the Housing Department and Immigration Department. And over the last half a year or so, we have been discussing with different departments, including the Working Family Agency and the Student Financial Assistance Agency. And if they have the particulars on record, we will conduct cross checking, and we would exempt these individuals from submitting information. So with which departments would you conduct this cross-matching or cross-checking? Would the REO proactively reach out to other departments? We would actively contact other departments, and if we can obtain such information from other departments, we would not require the elector to show proof of address. Since so many departments, other departments deal with the public, and I guess you will no longer need to ask for proof from the electors themselves. How many departments are you working with? We have been in touch with many departments. Some of them do require proof of address, but the address provided might not be the residence address. And according to the IRO, they are not the IRD is not allowed to pass on the particulars to any third party. So we would actively get in touch with different departments. I'd like them to tell us in writing which departments they are collaborating. Can the administration offer a written response to Mr. Chair? Yes, a lot of government departments possess personal particulars, but we would not carry out cross-checking casually because some information is not collected for the purpose of voter registration, and if the individuals concerned do not know that we will carry out the cross-matching, there might be legal repercussions. So apart from the Immigration Department, we will discuss with other departments on how this can be implemented. We can provide an answer in writing. Thank you.
We have
Mr. Chen Chin, the last to speak. We are here to discuss the requirement for address proof for voter registration in order to prevent people from registering fake address, because our constituency is too small. Just imagine the whole of Hong Kong is one single constituency. We have one man, one vote to elect the CE. There wouldn't be any problem. So, whether the person lives in Hong Kong, Kowloon, or New Territories. But then we have our district council elections. Some members just said auto-registration. That would not resolve the problem. Even if you became automatically a voter, you still need to register address to confirm which constituency you will go to vote. You still need to confirm your address before you can participate in these elections. Since you have to deal with the problem of people submitting fake addresses and therefore requiring address proof, so I don't understand why some members have two different, points. So whether it's a third party who, changed the address of a voter, or people deliberately submitting, fake addresses, you still need to address the problem. So I don't quite understand what's the difficulty on the part of the government. Of course, today we've seen that the members from the pro-government camp is inclined that people who move should be required to provide address proofs, but for new registration, we can do it later. For the pan-democratic camp, they say that we should do it at the same we impose the requirement at the same time. What I'd like to discuss instead is that you are proposing to advance the statutory deadline for new registration and align it with those who want to change the registration particulars. I believe your original intention was that for people who want to change the registration particulars, you want to enable them to vote in the constituency where they live. So therefore, what you're proposing now doesn't solve the problem. If you introduce a requirement for address proofs, even for the person you want to, extend the deadline for people who want to amend the residence details, I think someone can use the voter register for the last election, can still try to tamper with other voters, addresses. I think the most serious problem is that you've lost some of the voter particulars. So is it that, can a third party, cancel a voter's, eligibility as voter, Can a third party maliciously try to cancel the eligibility of another voter? So we've not come across such instances, but let me explain that. Last year, we already, set the deadline on for May the 2nd for new registration and also for people who want to change their registration particulars. This is because the new registration is late. The requirement of new registration is later for the deadline for change of particulars. And there's always a possibility for people or third party to impersonate another voter and change his particulars. So what we're now doing is that for change of address, we are advancing the deadline for one month so that our colleagues at the LEO can deal with large volumes of these address proofs. They would need to check. They have to check whether or not these addresses are genuine, whether there are any doubts. We believe that at the initial stage, despite our publicity, some members of the public may not know that they have to supply address proofs. So we need to get in touch with these voters and to tell them that they need to supply such details. Otherwise, we will not be able to help them proceed. And that takes time. And that's why we're proposing to advance the deadline by 1 month, because we want to ensure the authenticity of the voters' particulars. Okay. How about voters whose eligibility has been cancelled by a third party? For a voter who wants to cancel his eligibility as a voter, they will need to submit a written application. He will need to supply his ID number and also sign a written, you know, application. The numbers in previous years would be around 200 to 400 a year, so the number has stayed rather stable. I think with that, we may now wrap up our discussion on this item, and I'd like to thank the administration for coming. Next item is the work progress and strategic focuses of the Equal Opportunities Commission. We may now invite the representatives from the EOC to come into the chamber. Before the meeting, we have received some submissions from deputations, which are also appended to our agenda and circulated members. We've also receive a submission from Hong Kong Unison, and that has also been circulated already. Right, we will now invite the representative from the EOC to join us. Let me first of all invite Professor Chen from the EOC to brief us on the work of the EOC. Thank you, and good afternoon, members. Today, I'm very happy to come here to brief members on the work of the EOC and our latest developments. The EOC is responsible for enforcing the four anti-legislation ordinances to promote the value of equal opportunities and to build an inclusive society. In 2016 was an important milestone for the Commission. We were set up in 1996, and we have now operated in Hong Kong for 20 years. Over the last 20 years, the EOC, in eliminating discrimination and promoting equal opportunities, have laid down solid foundations. We've done a lot of important work. We've worked hard to tackle issues of discrimination, including the ethnic minorities and unequal treatment faced by the disabled, and also discriminatory practices such as and harassment at the workplace. Last year, the EOC published two important reports with policy implications, one being the review of our anti-discrimination ordinances, and the government has given us a very positive response. We submitted a submission to the government. The other one is to enact legislation to, you know, ban discrimination against sexual orientation and so on, and that has also stimulated a lot of discussion in our society. Those reports has actually some of the experience in tackling discrimination by the EOC in the last two decades. We also mapped out our vision for Hong Kong going forward. We're very pleased that in respect of the two examples I mentioned just now, namely the discrimination ordinances and the report on tackling discrimination against sexual orientation. The government has given us a positive response. Earlier, the government has indicated, well, we're also very surprised that we have proposed 9 areas of review for our discrimination ordinance. We proposed 27. We made 27 proposals. The government has decided to start with 9 of those proposals. We hope that these 27 proposals, we hope the government, when the new administration takes up its office, they will implement all those recommendations. All our 73 recommendations, we hope, will be able to implement it soon. On sexual orientation and bisexuals, we have seen that in the policy agenda of the administration, they have already, promised to, initiate some measures, and the Secretary of Justice had indicated that they will be launching a consultation paper on discrimination against sexual minorities. We will continue to achieve our mission, and in promoting the work of equal opportunities, we will continue to work hard in order that we'll be more focused and to make greater achievements. The governing committee has already worked out to prepare a work plan for the next 3 years. We have 5 major policy directions, and the 5 policy objectives, I'll go through them very briefly. We include promoting legal reform, advancing the rights of ethnic minorities, promoting the rights of persons with disabilities, addressing discrimination and harassment issues, promoting diversity and inclusion, and finally, striving for our own organizational governance. Regarding our work plan going forward and our objectives, these have already been, uploaded to our website, and they're also covered in our paper. The major terms of reference of the UC is to implement 4 anti-discrimination ordinances to promote channels for redress. We provide legal assistance. We also promote legal reform so that we can perfect the laws and to protect the rights of the people. The laws other than the laws the law will only provide the minimum threshold. To do better, we need to eliminate prejudices and discriminatory attitudes, and that will require long-term education. Furthermore, our society, our social environment keeps changing all the time. And in the face of discrimination, the question of discrimination is becoming more and more complicated. Let me quote 2 examples to explain why the work that we are doing is becoming more and more complex. In the past, we had disabled people whom we thought that we can providing them, a safe, security would do. But nowadays, for disabled persons, as far as the access to equal opportunities is concerned, I've seen a young girl sitting on a wheelchair, and I can use that as an example to illustrate how complex the problem is. This young girl told me that while she was disabled when she was young, but she has completed her university studies, and she's also very conversant with IT, but she felt that society is still discriminating against her being a disabled person. Although we can already take care of her needs, both financially and also in terms of her daily needs. But she said that she does not just want people's sympathy. She wants society to give her a better chance so that in terms of employment, she can really leverage on her potential. She wanted our society to, you know, pay attention to her ability and not her disability. In other words, so we should look at her ability, focus on her ability rather than her disability. So on this subject, even though we provide equal opportunities for equal development for the disabled, we should help these disabled persons to better leverage on their abilities and potential. Another problem we face is that our society is becoming more advanced. We need to speak out on behalf of the minorities. Equal opportunity is particularly important for the minorities. Some people in society believe that equal opportunities should not just cater to the needs of the minorities. We should fight we shouldn't just fight for justice on the behalf. We think that's wrong. We should fight for equal opportunities for the minorities. We should fight for justice.
不要，当然同时咧，我哋亦都令到
We should not ignore their needs, and we should make sure that the interests of the majority would be respected. And it's indeed difficult to strike a balance in any open and advanced society. We have to listen to the minority and respect everyone's rights. Some people feel that equal opportunities is only something extra, and in today's society, it's not important to think about equal opportunities. But I believe that equal rights is a cornerstone of Hong Kong. And compared with other Asian cities, this is one of the advantages of Hong Kong. We have an open and inclusive society. Professor, I think you have to speed up because we have questions coming. Yes, I only need a few more minutes. This way they can showcase their talents and they can contribute to our economy. We realize that it takes time to build an inclusive society.
可能有需要会稍后 extend 15分钟，但系啊，主席
If necessary, we might extend the meeting by 15 minutes. But I hope that I hope that Professor Chen would go faster. So, Chairperson, would you try to wrap up quickly? I only need a minute or two. Thank you very much. The ELC faces an enormous challenge in terms of resources. We have to continue to carry out our functions. And starting from the new year, starting from 2015 to 16, we have to follow the government's 011 plan in shrinking our budget. And with rising expenditure, we face great challenges. But even in face of the shortage of resources, we will continue to do our best in mainstreaming equal opportunities. And I hope members and the public would support that. Thank you very much.
嗱，咁我而家咧就收到已经举咗手会发言嘅同事，我多读个字序。
I'll read out the names of members who wish to speak. Dr. Lena Wong, Ms. Claudia Mo, Mr. Nathan Law, Mr. Horace Chang, Dr. Priscilla Leung, Mr. Ray Chan, Dr. Fernando Chang, and myself. Does anyone else wish to speak? If not, 4 minutes each, including question and answer. We received a motion moved without notice from Ms. Claudia Mo, and we will deal with that before the end of the meeting. Dr. Helena Wong, please. I have a few simple questions. First of all, in terms of legal assistance, in 2016, you granted 16 cases. Do you have a fixed budget every year on legal assistance? The answer is no. We are not imposing any caps. On average, we spend about $1 million on legal assistance. So if you receive more cases, then you would help them as much as possible, right? Of the of the 39 applications, you only granted 16 cases, depending on demand. And the our legal and complaints committee would vet the applications. So does it mean that you think that some of the cases were not worth helping? All the cases are worth helping, but our consideration would be on the complexity of the application and whether they can be handled by themselves. I have a comment on the anti-discrimination ordinances and the relevant amendments. The government identified only nine areas, but the report carried dozens of recommendations, but the government only chose nine, and there's no timeline. So this is actually not a question. I'd like you to ask the government when the government will work on those nine recommendations, and how about the and also the remaining 20 recommendations. I'd like to ask about sexual harassment. In paragraph 30 of the paper, you listed your efforts, and it's shocking that sexual harassment is still rife in various sectors, and I have heard a number of disturbing cases. First of all, in the psychiatric ward of a hospital, sexual harassment between patients, and in homes for the mentally handicapped, the patients are harassed by staff, and the male dormitory of HKU had a scandal of bullying or sexual harassment between same-sex roommates. Have you talked to the hospital authority and the LWB and the Education Bureau? How can they stop sexual harassments at various premises? What have you done in this respect? Thank you very much. In terms of education against sexual harassment, we made a lot of efforts this year. We had over 250 training sessions and over 10,500 participants took part.
各方面的人士呢, 包括一些公營機構、政府部門,
and these members include members from government departments, public bodies, NGOs, law firms, airlines, banks, etc. Sexual harassment is rather difficult to understand for the public, and at the workplace we find sexual harassment prevalent, and some people are being sexually harassed without knowing. I'm just asking how the EOC can help them. Can you give us an answer? Education is important so that so that people can lodge complaints. Have you got in touch with HKU, DHA, and persons in charge of the university dorms? Yes, we were in touch with homes for the mentally handicapped and the disabled. And would you offer guidelines for them to follow? Our training committee has been our training division is drafting guidelines against sexual abuse or sexual harassment. And we have education courses for parents and the persons in charge at the homes. Are you providing legal assistance? Can you offer a brief answer, please? Have you approached the HAU student? We have not got in touch with him yet. Dr. Wong, sorry, time is up. Other members are also waiting to speak. Ms. Claudia Mo, thank you very much. For ethnic minorities in Hong Kong, 20 years ago we were talking about their rights, but 20 years on, we are still talking about it. I'm happy that you have made the first step in reforming the law. And in the racial discrimination ordinance, you would stipulate that when the government carries out its functions, they could not discriminate against race. And as you know, an EM youth sued the police that they use discriminatory language, but they lost the case in court because the ordinance does not cover the police as part of the government, and as well as their behaviors or language when they discharge their duties, and these have been exempted under the existing ordinance. So you have made this very good first step. Are you confident that it can be done within the next 3 years? We have proposed to the government, and we hope for a positive response, and together with the support of LegCo, I think the government would provide a positive response. Has the government provided any timeline? And in paragraph 13, you said you would discuss with them within the next 3 years, in other words, before the end of the current LegCo. Are you confident that the reform can be implemented? We'll continue to talk to the government. For your EM unit, you are applying for around $4.5 million per year. And whereas our government is spending hundreds of tens of billions all the time, and $4.5 million is just a very small figure. Will the government regularize the work of the ethnic minority unit so you won't have to apply for funding regularly? Thank you very much for your suggestion. In terms of salaries, funding is already provided, and we have no funds yet for events. We hope that the government can provide regular funding as well, because events can benefit EMs. How much would that cost approximately per year? How much would you ask for every year? Around $5 million. All right. Ms. Mo, anything else? No. Thank you very much. Next, Mr. Nathan Law. Thank you very much. According to the government's and LegCo's papers, I think the government is being very harsh to the EOC. They are not providing enough funds, and they are not being very kind to them. According to the paper, and the study on legislation against discrimination on sexual orientation, gender identity, and intersex status has been published over a year ago, and the public generally supports legislation, but the government did not listen. So what is the issue? Is it because the EOC lacks power, and do they need extra support or powers in order to push through the reform? And from 1999 to 2013, the UN Human Rights Committee pointed out that Hong Kong lacks an independent committee to investigate on matters against human rights. Why did the government refuse this proposal? Does the government feel that the EOC has enough powers to discharge their duties? And for Professor Chen, do you think the EAC should become an independent body in order to monitor cases of human rights? In terms of financial assistance, we understand the plight of the EOC. the government does not know that costs are rising and rents are expensive. And in the 2018 to 19 financial year, DOC will use up all its reserves. And if that happens, it will become the joke of the world. Are you going to provide enough recurrent funding to cover rents and rising costs due to inflation, etc.? Chairperson? In terms of promoting the law reform, DOC has no power. The DOC operates independently, but in terms of our powers, we do face certain restrictions, and the government might better off take this question. And Professor Chen, do you think there should be a study to look at the or to assess the transformation of the DOC into an independent body to monitor human rights? We were set up based on the four anti-discrimination ordinances. If we are to expand our scope into a body for human rights, I think more discussions is needed within the commission. Thank you.
Chairman, I think I will answer the question regarding resources. Let me supply some figures for our members. Over the last few years, our subvention for the EOC has been increasing. For a few years, the subvention remained more or less steady. There have been ups and downs of 1 or 2%, but for 2014, the increase was 12.5%. It was mainly because we have given the EOC $4.69 million per annum. I'd like to be more specific. The EOC for in 2018-29 will be exhausting all its reserves. Will the government try to increase its subsidy for the EOC so that the commission will not run into deficit every year and be out of its reserves every year? Chairman, for 2017-2018, other than the routine subsidies, we have provided a special cash subsidy of $9.5 million to help the EOC relocate. They will be relocating to a new premises at near the Wong Chuk Hang MTR station. It's within 5 minutes walk of the station. So the rents will be cheaper there. And in dealing with the funding application from the EOC, now if the EOC successfully relocate, then I don't think the reserves of the EOC will be depleted so quickly. Administratively, if we would explore whether or not the UC could use its resources, in a better manner. But I think we will not ignore the problem confronting the UC, and in fact, the subvention we give the UC has been increasing every year. Mr. Cheng Kwok Kwan, in 2016, the number of complaints and inquiries received were up compared with 2015, which shows that people are very concerned about discrimination. There were 9,700-odd inquiries, 5,900-odd specific inquiries, which may result into complaints. In respect of these numbers, I'd like to ask a question about the general inquiries and specific inquiries. What are the nature, what sort of discrimination are they related to? How many of them are related to discrimination against people with different sexual orientations? Thank you. In the annex, you'll find some numbers. In Annex A, you'll find the breakdowns here. regarding, I think most of the complaints, topping list will be disability, discrimination, followed by sexual discrimination. Discrimination against people with different sexual orientation will come under the category of sexual discrimination. Perhaps our chief executive could further elaborate. For the general inquiries, they do not include, they're not included under the four legislation that we enforce. They would include inquiries like people calling up the EOC, asking what sort of work we do, what are our terms of reference, what are the promotional events or education activities that we have planned. For specific inquiries, they would involve the four anti-discrimination ordinances, the FSDO, the SDO, the RDO, and the DDO. For such inquiries, they are more personal in nature. The person making inquiry may say, if I'm faced with such a situation, would this constitute sexual or discrimination or disability discrimination? And for such specific inquiries, they may involve very specific, problems, for example, age discrimination, which do not come under the ambit of our four pieces of legislation. As for complaints about discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation, well, we do not have the power to enforce the law in this regard. However, we do have compiled some statistics. The number of such complaints are not that many every month for every quarter, because the majority of the members of the public understand that the EOC doesn't have any authority to enforce the law in this respect. I don't quite understand your last point. You said you have not received many such complaints, but you're saying that the public understands that that you don't have the authority to deal with the problem. Yes, some members of the public already knows very well that the EOC's knows about the terms of reference of the EOC, and some members of the public may call us up and ask questions relating to sexual orientation. They may say that they have been subject to some sort of discrimination because of their sexual orientation. But the number of complaints we have received are not that many. Our guess is that the reason for that is that many people understand the limits of our terms of reference. Next, Ms. Priscilla Leung. Thank you. Regarding the question of sexual orientation and whether or not we should enact legislation to ban discrimination against that. In the paper provided by the UC and our secretariat, you'll find a big discrepancy. The paper by our secretariat is very fair. They have outlined different views on the subject. The UC, on the other hand, is very unfair and impartial. In paragraph 32, other than Dr. York Chow, the previous chairman, whom we say was not fair and impartial to be the chairman of the EOC, in paragraph 2, obviously it shows that you are being very biased here. Professor Chen, at one of our previous meetings, publicly claimed that there is already a major consensus within our society that we should enact legislation to deal with discrimination against people against sexual orientation. I pointed out that what you were saying was not true, and that I represented many people in Hong Kong to object to the proposal to enact legislation to tackle the problem relating to sexual orientation, and you turned a deaf ear to that. And last time you said that there were many objections against your proposal. You say that they were all, complaint letters of the same problem. And you actually signed a joint declaration with the gender research center. But you make a joint statement, how can you say that you're objective when you say that you already have collected views of the major retailers, NGOs, religious bodies? I think this paragraph itself is biased. I must express my regret here. And secondly, according in paragraph 14 of the paper prepared by our secretariat, I'm a member of that working group chaired by Professor Fanny Zhang. Your conclusion, obviously, was there were many people present at that on that occasion supporting the sexual minorities, and they prefer they not taking the legislative approach. When we conducted the study, we invited the government representative to give us, show us the many issues which have arisen after they have enacted such a legislation. The working group conclusion that we should not tackle the problem by legislation. Is it that the EOC only want to listen to what you hear, what you want to hear? And as for the different problems arising in other jurisdictions. In the UK, some couples indicated they were against same-sex marriage, and they didn't. Then the right to adopt a child was deprived of them. But you didn't hear that. You only heard was single voice, and you also made a joint statement with another organization. How can you say you are being objective? You've come here today say we should enact legislation as soon as possible. Have you considered the conclusion by our working group in which we said that we could resolve the problem through administrative measures rather than exaggerating and further aggravating this problem? So I'd like to ask the government, you've set up the EOC, and I can bear witness I mean, when I read paragraph 32, I'm really infuriated. You are incorporating all these religious bodies which objected to what you're proposing. Parent organizations, professional groups objected, but you turn a blind eye to that. I'd like to see how fair is the EOC. Professor? Thank you, Ms. Leung, for your question. I believe this is a subject we've had exchanged our views on many occasions already. Of course, the EOC doesn't have the authority to deal with the question of same-sex marriage. We have always insisted that we should not allow any person to be subject to bully or discrimination. And because of that, according to our consultation, we found that in Hong Kong there are people who have been discriminated against or bullied because of their sexual orientation. And because of that, we urge the government to enact a consultation on whether or not we should legislate. We're not proposing we should immediately enact a legislation. We're saying that we should, you know, initiate extensive consultation. Whereas whether or not to initiate legislation is the decision for the government. Have you ever heard, have you deleted all these, cases of discrimination? Is anything, would the administration like to make a brief response? We have incorporated the views of all the stakeholders. Members of the EOC board also hold different views. The request for the government to enact legislation against discrimination based on sexual orientation, the board also support that. The government agrees that this is a sensitive issue and that there are divergent views on the topic, so we need to tackle it carefully. What we are doing now, like Ms. Leung said, we've looked at the other jurisdictions and compare the situation before and after they have enacted legislation against such discrimination, how they implement how they enforce the law, and what has been the outcome. So that's been very useful reference for us. As I said, at the next panel meeting, we will be having a more detailed discussion with members. It's now 4:30, and a few members have yet to speak. So may I propose that we extend our meeting by 15 minutes so that we have sufficient time to express our views. Mr. Chen Chi-Chun, if someone like Ms. Priscilla Leung feels that what the UC has done, or the studies and investigations that they've done in the past had not been comprehensive enough and that they are being impartial, that is all the more reason we should support the government to to conduct consultation on whether or not we should enact legislation to ban such discrimination. The government should clarify the issues, try to find out who is trying to hide the facts, who is trying to exaggerate certain points, like the reverse discrimination suggested by Priscilla Leung. Does it really exist, or is it just some rare examples, or is it that it's not really that serious a problem? The UC had mentioned this before, but the government has always been silent on this. The government, if the government thinks that the UC is wrong, the government should have a role to play. If Ms. Priscilla Leung and those who object to discrimination, if people like Ms. Leung is wrong and they've exaggerated the issue, the government also has a role to clarify and educate the public. Regrettably, the ASIA government and the Constitutional Affairs Bureau, although one of its duty is to promote human rights, but the resources they have committed, their policy and their attitude shows that they do not attach importance to helping the vulnerable and the minorities to fight for equal opportunities, both in terms of resource allocation, the policies and the attitude. Today, Mr. Tam is following the chief secretary on the duty visit to the Bay Area in Guangzhou. We don't even have the under secretary attending a meeting today, only the deputy secretary is here. We understand how to the extent to which she can answer our question. Our first question is that last year in January 2016, EOC published a report on the study on whether or not we should enact legislation against discrimination against LGBTI. Well, that report has been published for so long. What has the government done so far?
Has the government considered how to prepare for the consultation? Last month, you met 75 NGOs and private bodies, including law chambers, IT companies, etc. You urge the government to do something. So in a way, you are acting like an NGO yourself. You are urging the government. So have you been approached by the government? You submitted this report and nothing has been done. And I'd like to ask the government about the allocation of resources. I think the government will allow the EOC to survive, but they would not allow you to do a lot of things either. I understand that EOC has always been looking for a permanent venue. Taikoo is, of course, very expensive now, and now you're moving to Wangzhouhang, and later you might move to Shuttlecock in order to save rent. Like other statutory bodies, for example, the Hospital Authority, Consumer Council, they have permanent offices, so they won't have to pay high rents. So what is the government's view? Do you support them or otherwise? Is there any timeline? Professor Chen, thank you. Basically, we are waiting for a response from the government. We hope that the government will give us a positive feedback. So in other words, you have not been approached after publishing the report. In other words, they have not approached you. What about the office? Chairman, the government has always supported the EOC in sourcing a new office, whether it's a bought or rented property. If the EOC has any proposal, we would support them. In terms of the allocation of resources, the CMAB is not the only bureau who would make a decision. In terms of the relocation to Wangzhouhang, if you start from Admiralty, it's only a station or a stop away. It's even closer than Taikoo. And indeed, they can save on rents. We have provided 9.5 $1 million for the relocation. Hopefully that could help. If the EOC has any further proposal from the government's point of view, we would consider the proposal carefully because we are dealing with public money, but we will continue to support them. Dr. Fernando Chang, thank you. We certainly support the work of the Equal Opportunities Commission because it's an independent statutory body who promotes an inclusive and equal society. For the four anti-discrimination ordinances, DOC has to execute and promote these ordinances, and we hope that they are given enough resources for their work. But we also realize that the EOC is under great difficulties. One of their key functions is to handle complaints. And deal with aggrieved members of the public, especially in case of unfair treatment with regards to the four ordinances. Another function of the EOC should be to offer legal assistance if contraventions are involved, or even take certain cases to the court. But when we look at past figures, very few cases were taken to the court. The CTU, the CTU's Li Chengyan gave us some figures. They receive around 5,000 cases every year, and conciliation would be attempted for 600 of those. But in terms of offering legal assistance, only 40 cases succeeded. And those were figures from last year. And only 16 cases received legal assistance, and only 2 cases were taken to court eventually. So these figures are disappointing. We know that the EOC has more than 6 lawyers. And the legal costs every year are probably substantial. And the Hong Kong Unison said that since the racial discrimination ordinance was fully enacted in 2009, only 3 people received legal assistance, and only 1 case was taken to the courts with regards to RDO. So we are very concerned whether the EOC's operation has been effective, especially in providing legal assistance. Is there any room for improvement? Why was legal assistance given to so few cases, and even fewer were taken to the court? Without the courts or court cases, these ordinances would not be effective, and the EOC would be a toothless tiger, and at the end, they would only become a conciliator or messenger. They are just relaying the views back and forth, and they would not be able to help aggrieved parties. Perhaps the EOC chairperson and your team can explain that. I think after so many years, we have to review the EOC ordinance and its operation. And also, should we reinforce its provision of legal assistance? I suggest that this be discussed at the panel as soon as possible, and the public should also be allowed to offer their views. Professor Chan, thank you. Thank you very much. In the the design of EOC is not biased towards litigations. When we receive a complaint, we will carry out investigation in an objective manner, and if there's prima facie evidence, we will provide support to the complainant or the aggrieved party. And before that, we have to collect evidence in an unbiased manner. And at the end, we hope to resort to conciliation to resolve the matters rather than using litigation. So the design of the EOC is preempted on conciliation. After collecting evidence, we will carry out conciliation. Very often, 70 to 80% of the cases would have been resolved. And by the time we reach detailed investigation and when we have evidence, then both parties might be willing to conciliate. So at the end, the number of applicants for legal assistance would be rather low. We have not stopped anyone from applying for legal assistance. And our legal and complaints committee will adopt certain standards in when vetting their applications. So we only have 10 to 20 cases of litigation every year. So that explains the figures as well as our complaints handling mechanism and why we have had very few litigations, because the EOC is designed to rely more on conciliation. But at the end, some cases came to nothing after endless conciliation efforts. Can the EOC tell us whether it's time to review the EOC ordinance and its operation? Professor Chen? Yes. Since our discussion with Li Chuk-yan, our complaints and legal committees had been following up on this. We had a six-hour meeting yesterday on how our procedures can be streamlined and how we can help the complainants. We will take on board the recommendations and see how we can improve the entire process. What about the, do I have time to answer the question about lawyers? Our six lawyers don't just take charge of the litigation. They also support groups. They also offer support in drafting guidelines. So they carry out many functions. In our recent relocation, our lawyers had to deal with the legal provisions of contracts, so they have to provide internal support as well. So hopefully Dr. Cheng would be happy with this answer. All right. Since, well, I am yet to speak and Ms. Claudia Mo would like to move a motion, can we extend the meeting by another 15 minutes? Barring any objections, we can deal with Ms. Claudia Mo's motion moved without notice. Professor Chen, I have a question and also a comment. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the briefing. I'm also a member of the EOC. And I've seen that the EOC has done a good job in the past, and in many LegCo meetings have adopted comments submitted by the EOC. So that is an acknowledgement of your efforts. Today, a number of members talked about the legislation on gender or on sexual orientation. In Hong Kong, there are still great controversies on legislating on sexual orientation. I have met a number of school sponsoring bodies and religious groups, and they feel that if we resort to legislation in eliminating discrimination they are concerned, because there could be reverse discrimination and some religious groups are afraid that religious freedom might be jeopardized. If we are to legislate for sexual orientation, I have my reservations, and I feel that you must be very, very careful. As a member of the EOC, I saw that the EOC faced challenges in terms of resources, and I hope that the government would communicate with the EOC more often to consider their needs of resources. There's a lot of work they have to do, and they end up with very little resources. So hopefully the government can consider their needs.
I'd like to ask a question. According to paragraph 14 of the paper, you pointed out, you referred to the question of teaching the ethnic minority students Chinese as a second language. I understand that the EOC holds the position that you've heard the aspirations of many of the ethnic minorities, and that there is lack of support for teachers teaching ethnic minority students Chinese as a second language. And so my question is this. The EOC has already put forward its request to the administration. I'd like to ask whether the government has any response. I think this is something that we would like to relay to the Education Bureau. Perhaps the professor can further elaborate. Well, I don't think we should speak on behalf of the Education Bureau, but we have worked closely with the Bureau regarding the Chinese language framework. We have, after the Chinese language learning framework has been implemented, the Bureau knows that we are very concerned. And once we'll keep monitoring how the framework is being implemented, and also referring to the rights of the ethnic minorities. We've set up an ethnic minorities working group within the commission, and the working group has already started its work, and we have regular meetings with the Education Bureau. And a couple of months ago, we also had a meeting with the Permanent Secretary from the Bureau to discuss the question of service provision for the ethnic minorities, and that we should set up a special working group to take charge of that. At the Leshko Heso has formed a working group regarding the rights of ethnic minorities. We'd like to also tell members that 57% of the ethnic minority students actually dropped out at from their secondary studies, and the percentage for local students is only 5%. So there is a big difference there. So we are very concerned about this problem. We hope the working group on ethnic minorities in Lechko will also be concerned about this. I think we finished with all our questions, and we may now proceed. We may now need to ring the division bell so that members can come back for us to deal with the motion moved by Claudia Mo.
Okay. 好。
Yes, we now have a quorum, so we may now deal with the motion moved by Ms. Claudia Mo. The motion is now displayed on the screen. I would also like to invite Ms. Mo to read out his motion. This panel urges the Constitution and Mainland Affairs Bureau to enhance support for the work of the EOC and to provide sufficient financial resources for the Ethnic Minorities Division of the EOC in order that they can help tackle the unfair treatment received by the ethnic minorities. All right. All those in favor, please put up your hands. So it's unanimous. Dr. Helena Wong, of course we support the motion. But I just asked the Bureau why we don't even have a single accountable official present at our meeting. Is it that they do not take this panel or the EOC seriously? I think Mr. Chen Chichin asked the same question earlier. The answer is that they have now on a duty visit to the Bay Area. I don't think they are on a tour. It's a study tour. I don't think it should be the case that both the Secretary and the Deputy Secretary and the Under Secretary should go on the same tour. We should condemn the Bureau that the accountable officials are always absent from our meetings. Chairman, for this panel, I think the attendance rate of our politically accountable officers is quite satisfactory. Today is rather exceptional, but still, I think I am in a position to speak on behalf of the Bureau. Yes, those officials are now on the study tour in Guangdong. And also, the Permanent Secretary is in charge of this part of the Bureau's portfolio. Okay, we now come to the AOB. If there's no AOB, I now declare that our meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.